is a small clip. This is one of my mentors from whom I studied, and the emphasis is on everybody draws from the age of 10, most stop after that. And let's hear what he has to say.
Most people stop drawing around the age of 9 or 10 years old, you know, as other things start to happen in their lives and they become more interested in other things at school and demands. Computers nowadays, I got a lot of students here at Noman that are, you know, they come here with fabulous backgrounds in computers. I should know as much about computers as they do. I don't. In any case, you know, here we have adults, people who can balance their checkbooks, can do incredible things with a computer, can begin to sort of live as adults in a world which is highly complex, and then when they are told when they get here that they have to learn how to draw, and they start drawing again, horrors! They find that they're drawing like, the drawings look like they're done by 9 or 10 year olds, and they say, what's up with that? You know? Well, that's when they stop drawing. That's when they stop developing in that kind of situation.
So, the thing that he's talking about is that usually we as human beings, drawing is by far the most primal skill that we are born with, okay? And this is evident from just the history of art, if you look at it, Stone Age, cave paintings, whenever, you know, there has been no part in the history of mankind where there is not some or the other evidence of people creating art, okay? So art, we are all born with it. There's a saying that the only thing you can do with creativity is unlearn it. You know, you cannot learn creativity because we are born with it. And with, this is what he's giving emphasis on, that with time, with engagements, with obligations, with our outlook towards the world way we are trained, education system, blah, the whole thing takes us away from that one basic skill that we are born with, that is drawing. And this usually happens around the age of 8, 9, 10. Okay, when we start getting pulled into so many directions. And as we keep growing up, you know, we keep growing as a human being, and at some point in time, we come back to drawing. Everybody comes back to drawing at some point in time in their life, okay? Maybe they're 30, maybe they're 40. At some point in time, with their kids, with their grandkids, some point in time, people come back to drawing. And when they create that first drawing, okay, that's like the horror. I'm not an artist, I don't know how to draw. The funny thing is that when they draw their first drawing, that drawing is as good as a 9-year-old's drawing. So the skill that you've already learned, you'll never really lose it. The only thing that happens is that you kept growing, the artist in you didn't grow. Because to grow as an artist, you need to practice. Okay, and this is the key word in this session, in this entire time that you're going to spend with me, is that you have to practice. Okay, drawing is not a skill that you get better by doing it once. Drawing or painting or whichever form of creativity expression you undertake, eventually you will only get better by doing it more and more and more, and there is no replacement for that. Okay, so if you have not drawn since you're 9 years old, your first drawing will be like you used to draw as a 9-year-old, and then you'll grow from there. Okay? And if by chance you are fortunate enough to keep drawing, then we'll touch you on it.
I must be an exception, because when I try to draw now, it looks like a 2-year-old.
Ah, there you go.
I'm regressed, I think.
So I guess you didn't get much time drawing as a child also. My parents only had one requirement. As long as you finish your homework, you can do whatever you want to do. So, I mean, I actually grew up in a very, very protected environment, and my mother was very happy to provide me with whatever supplies I needed. So I never really...
I mean, when we were growing up and going to school in, say, Bondi, even though we had an art class, nothing much happened there.
Yeah, it was an obligatory... I had the same thing.
Yeah.
I grew up with art classes everywhere.
I remember we had an art
teacher drawing.
Sketchbook.
Yeah.
And the teacher would come and... he would draw a hat on the board, and you have to copy that. You know,
that's it.
So you have to like color it according to what he wanted to do.
Yes,
exactly.
That's the basis of our education system, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you get it right by the book, you're okay. If you say anything outside the book,
and
it's not.
It was a class of freedom. You know, all the other classes were, you know, yeah. This class you can actually move around and sit with your friends.
Yeah, make a little bit of a
exactly.
They used to take us out in the schoolyards and
yes,
you know, make that tank, make that track, make that bus.
That would have helped us. That's why I had to on the board.
Yeah. Anyways, so that's why the learning curve of drawing is basically you start with a graphite pencil, okay, and then you go from graphite to charcoal, charcoal to color pencil to watercolors to poster colors to acrylics, acrylics to oil. And I mean the world is open to you, okay. But the first thing you have to learn is how to draw and how to shape, okay. Just getting the form is not enough. You have to also learn how to make it live in the real world. So in real world, we get light, we get bounce light, we get color, we get all these things. Okay, so all these things we have to learn. You have a question?
I was like homeschooled from a very young age.
Yeah.
So and my mom like put a huge emphasis on like learning how to draw properly,
yeah,
and you know watercolors and stuff. And she had this like curriculum. So basically, kids drawing curriculum. There were four books. And I almost got it into the fourth book. Like I was pretty good when she made me start public school.
Yeah.
And then I stopped drawing for like around 5-6 years.
Yeah.
And after coming to your school, when I had to draw like the cell diagram,
yeah,
like it took me like an hour to do it fully. And then I just looked at myself like, I'm a disappointment to my family.
Yeah.
And since now I have to, and now I have to just go back to the first book and learn how to do it all. Do it all again, it's frustrating.
We will follow some techniques which will fast track your learning, because these techniques have been developed by artists who went in the industry and then realized, oh, we know how to do this, but this is not the requirement. So they have to quickly learn what is the requirement. So in that process, they have developed many techniques that are very easy to absorb and very easy to implement, and that should speed up your learning process a bit. But that depends on every single individual. Okay, so we'll find out when we start the sessions. Okay, so the mediums are these, and then the kind of things that you'll learn is subjects would be landscapes. So it could be a cityscape, an open grassland, mountainscape. There are many, many different names for different types of scapes. Overall, they are known as landscapes. Still life drawing, so we'll have objects which will be lit automatically, and we'll learn how to draw them and color them. And then figure drawing, so we'll study human anatomy and we'll learn how to draw the human figure in a pose, which is known as gesture drawing. And you will learn how to pose them, how to seat them, how to put weight. And then once you learn clothing, you'll learn how to wrap clothing around your characters, how to put folds, how to hang them, you know, all those weight and all those things you learn as part of your the principles that you learn for finger drawing. Next. Portrait. So finally, you learn how to draw fish, because mostly we interact with people here, and we might be learning portrait before we do the figure, because we will learn the head and we learn how to make the bones. And we'll learn how to put muscles on top of that, and we'll learn how to put skin on top of that, and shave it, and then put clothing and fur, hair, you know, all the other features that are part of this learning. Next. Okay, so now we are going to come into the 3D animation part of it. Okay, so now the next slides that you're going to see is basically a computer-based implementation of all the skills that we've learned till now. Okay, so the learning process here is actually very fast. It's very easy to learn softwares. And with all of us growing up with technology in our very hands, you will really fast, very quickly. I mean, I don't think anybody is here who doesn't use a computer, yeah? Windows, a Mac, a Linux, whichever. Basic, you use your phone, right? That's a full-fledged computer right there. So basic interacting with an electronic device you already know. And all you need to know which button to press to do what, okay? And this we can teach you in, literally I can teach you the entire software of Maya in 1 week for you to start doing what you're going to do as a student. Obviously, when you start working professionally, you have to learn way more, but the foundation is very, very easy. So what we're going to do is, we'll quickly learn the steps that we need to learn for each module, and there are six of them, and then we will start implementing what we have learned as a skill in that 3D environment. Okay? So the first module is modeling. So modeling is, there are some technical terms you'll see here, polygon, NURBS, subdivision modeling, and we can use it, I've only used the word hyperreal, but we can also use cartoony, we can use caricaturized, we can use alien, fantastical creature, everything, whatever you can imagine or you can look at, you can recreate inside 3D animation software like Maya. Okay? And these are the three major technologies, polygons, NURBS, and subdivisions, which we'll learn the technology part of it when we learn the software. Okay? They are used for creating all these. Now, once you've created the model, they're basically gray, and then we implement all the things that we have learned in color theory. So when modeling, we'll implement all the things we learned in human anatomy and perspective drawings, and in texturing, we'll learn all the things that we learned in color theory to create contrast, to create mood, to create even character design. You know, the example that you see here, that one is actually a predatory spider. So you can see it's all bright red, yellows. You know, because they want to dominate. You know, they want to attack. They want to surprise their prey, so that you know the prey gets stunned and they can quickly take care of it. So the colors in nature are actually designed like that. More aggressive creatures have brighter colors. You know, less aggressive creatures, because they need to hide, so they blend well. You know, they have more blending colors. They are more in tune. Classic example is a chameleon. Then you can change color as it goes from place to place. Okay, so we'll implement those. So in this case, we will learn something called UV mapping, projection mapping, hyper shading. These are the technical terms that we will learn inside of Maya, and then we'll use our skills to apply the textures. And there are inbuilt painting tools inside Maya where you can directly use a brush to paint on a 3D surface. Okay, so these are the technological advances in Maya which we can use. And these are not unique to Maya by any means, okay? But Maya is one of the softwares, and by far one of the most popular softwares that is implemented this. So I'll show you a small clip of a showreel of a modeler. And in the industry, you just cannot apply as a modeler. You have to know how to do modeling and texturing together. So this is a skill set which is required in one artist together. Okay, you don't just go in and create models and then nobody knows how to texture them, because there are some technical requirements in the model so that the texture can be done properly. If those technical requirements are not met, the texture artist will not be able to do texture. So eventually they were having so much conflict that they combined these two departments and make a model. So modeling and texturing is one department. Okay, so I'll show you a clip. And the showreel of a modeler, and this is the kind of showreel you'll have to prepare if you want to go in the industry and work. Okay, next. Next one, character animation. So the part that I've not spoken here is actually very, very technical. Once you've created the model, you're not able to move the model just by grabbing the model directly. Okay, so there is a technical aspect where you actually create a skeletal system inside the model, similar to the skeletal system of the creature that you're creating. And there is, so the process is called rigging and skilling. Okay, so this is very technical, so I've not made it a part of the presentation. But before you do animation, there is a department called rigging and skinning, which puts that skeleton inside, prepares all the controls for facial animation, and puts all the controls for FX animation like hair and cloth. And all those things are done by this department called rigging and skinning. And then they make it ready for animation. Right after modeling and texturing, the model is not ready for animation. So it has to be made ready for animation. Once it's ready for animation, it goes to the animation department. And the animator is required to know how to use that rig that the rigging department has here. So it has controls the animator can grab and move and close fingers and, you know, do whatever kind of animation that he wants to do. You're not going to have whatever animation is required. The animator is required to be able to use that rig. So that is a technical skill that an animator is required. Plus the animator is required to be able to implement the 12 principles of animation. Okay, so this is by far the most lucrative and highly paid. It's not the highest paid, but it is highly paid job in the industry. The highest paid job is the one that is not in the slide. That is the rigging and skinning, because it requires you to know programming, some level of programming. Maya has an inbuilt embedded language called MEL, which is Maya embedded language, which this rigging and skinning team will utilize to automate a lot of processes inside Maya, so that when the animator is animating, he's not struggling with the technology. He can easily just work towards animating, and if something is not working, it's not his job to fix it. He will send it back to the rigging department, and they have to fix the problems and send it back so that he doesn't have to struggle with technology. All he has to do is hold the controls and start animating. Okay? So the riggers and skinners and the programmers are the highest paid. Of course, character animation is second to none. This is where you bring characters to life, this is where you tell your stories. The more skilled artists you have in this department, the better your animation looks, the faster they work, the less budget you spend. And so this is a very, very in-demand skill set. Okay? And what I'll do is, I will show you a clip of one of the animators who work in the industry. And next slide. everything that you saw that was alive was animated by an animal. Okay, and so that could include not just humans and creatures, that could even include cars. You see Cars, the movie by itself. The cars are the characters. So the character animator is doing that. Okay, all the things, nuances that he puts in the animation that makes it feel like the inanimate object is alive is done by the animator. Okay, and there was one clip in which you saw a close-up of the eye. Okay, and you saw that it changes into a mechanical thing and all that. So all the transformation is developed by the R&D team. But how the transformation happens, how the sequence is animated, is done by an animator. Okay, because it should look realistic. It should function like it would function in the real world. And this is the job of the animator, to make things move realistically. Okay? Okay, next slide. Okay, then the next thing is dynamics. And dynamics is basically 3D visual effects. Okay? There is, visual effects is broken into two parts. One is 3D, which is done in the 3D animation software. And the other is 2D, which is done post-production. So I'll talk about that when we are studying post-production. In the meantime, if you guys have any questions, please feel free to ask. Okay, this is an interactive session. You can stop me at any point in time. And don't wait for the end of the class to ask the questions. Okay. So basically what happens is, this is done through the technology called simulation. Okay. This physical simulations are inbuilt inside Maya. Okay? So let's say I want to animate that a character is throwing a ball. So the part the character is throwing a ball is hand animated, but once the ball leaves the character's hand, the physics that it will follow is done through simulation. Okay? So what they do is, they can actually assign physical properties to the ball and the object it is colliding with. Okay? So they can assign the density, the weight, the mass of the ball as it would be in real world. And they can create this surface as a collision surface and put a gravity field on it. So if it is on Earth, they would put the gravity field of Earth, which is I think 9.8 kilometers an hour or meters an hour or centimeters, one of those. Okay. With which a thing gets pulled towards Earth, the speed with which a thing gets. So you can assign all those things, and then when he leaves the ball will get the actual physical dynamics of a real world ball doing that. Okay. Similarly for fire, similarly for explosion, smoke, buildings crumbling, planes crashing, robots fighting, you know, so all those things where the once the character animator has animated a robot hitting another robot, where the robot hits him, all the crumbling, all the destruction that is happening is based in simulation. Okay? Hair simulation, cloth simulation. They will not animate cloth by hand. In some cases they do, but most of the cases they will not animate the cloth by hand. Most of the cases they will not animate hair by hand. Okay? Unless they have a very, very specific requirement for the hair to do something very, very specific that you cannot control through simulation, which is very rare. Okay? So you can see there's a man on fire, the bike is on fire. So all these things are done through 3D visual effects. Okay? These are done inside the software. Next slide. So I'll show you a clip of a showreel of done through real world physics, which are inbuilt in the software.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
In this shot of the debris simulation,
yeah.
Do they have to create each piece separately, or there
no. So there's a plugin which unevenly cracks, creates cracks in the model. But the modeling has to be done so that those cracks can be created.
Yeah. And you can kind of increase it, you say
50%
and so on.
Yes, so if you have little debris, you'll basically make a low poly model. It will have less number of polygons. And if you have very great polygons, so you need your polygons to be that small, so that those small pieces can be taken out. There are, I mean, these things can be done in Maya also, but there are specified softwares, like for this kind of simulation, there is a software called Houdini, which is used primarily for extensive destruction. And, but Maya has five major, now maybe six, hair, cloth, fur, fluid, that is physical simulation. These are earlier Maya used to come in two versions, Maya and Maya Unlimited. So Maya Unlimited had all the particles, gravity, fluid and all that. Fluid no, particles, gravity, real world physics and all that. And then there were these five modules which were added to Maya and called Maya Unlimited, which was fur, hair, cloth, fluid and life. So life was, life is actually a post-production technology which was inbuilt in Maya, which is called 3D camera tracking. This is something they learned in post-production, where they actually shoot something in real world, and then they are able to simulate the camera movement in the real world, in the camera, which is in the 3D world. Sorry, that's a mouthful. But yeah, so they can actually simulate the movement of the camera that was done by the cameraman in real world, and have a camera inside Maya, which starts moving exactly like that. And then they can create the animation in that FOV, and then they can superimpose it in post-production, which we'll learn. It will be part of everything that we learn. Okay? Anybody has any other questions?
What about pixels? Do they actually put in the pixels there, or is it the...
No, pixel is not part of the software. Pixel is part of the visual. Pixel is basically the smallest unit of display on the screen. So pixels are used for showing the image. So depending on the resolution of your screen, you have more or less pixels.
Yes, but then if you're creating a character, then you need to make it look realistic, then you have to...
So it's not pixels, it's called polygons. You have to increase the number of polygons. Polygons are the smallest. When I was showing you the modeling reel, there was a part where the character was standing and you could see the grid. That grid, each block inside that grid is known as a polygon. So it could be four-sided, five-sided, six-sided, depending on how much more detail you get into. Okay, so the more detail you want, the more number of, and the same thing is required for the simulation, the more breakage, smaller particles you need, the more number of polygons you need, so that the overall object can break into so many parts. Okay, so depending on the production, because the more number of polygons you have, the more time the computer will take to do the work. So depending on, depending on the amount of detail you want to see, your production budget, your time budget, everything goes up or down. Okay, so they will try to cut down on any extra work, any extra polygons to reduce the time that you require to work with them. Okay, this is the major difference between how they work in movies and how they used to work in games. Okay, now with PS5 and all, it's almost the same. But earlier, game engines could not support so many polygons. That is why anybody who has played the earlier Lara Croft games, you'll see that in-game, while you're playing the game, it's very, you can see edges on the character, you know, because it's very low poly. And then in cinematics, you see round because they are pre-rendered. They are not rendering while you're playing. So that was the limitation of the console. Okay, that is why on PC, you have the best quality, depending on what kind of PC you have. But consoles have a limitation because consoles don't have different memories, and they're just one console and you have to buy it like that. But now with PS5 and all, the technologies, hardware technology is the same as PC. So you can get the same level of detail when you're playing on a gaming PC and when you're playing on a PS5. it's near realistic. It's near real time and near realistic. Of course, the look and feel, the style is very stylized, but I recommended last time also, the students who were present, to watch a clip on YouTube, Matrix Awakens demo on PS5, gameplay demo on PS5. Watch that clip and you will see how far technology has come, both in terms of software and hardware. Okay? Shall I go on? Yeah? No. One minute, yeah. So the last part in Maya is known as rendering. Now rendering is the process where you export from Maya so that you can show it to others. Because everything you make in Maya, if other people have to see it, they will have to buy Maya to be able to see it. Okay? So basically you export it as an image or a sequence of images if it's animation for people to see and for you to do maybe editing and post-production on it. Okay? So this is the technology which allows you to take your scenes and convert them into series of images or stills. Okay? And Maya has, at the time I was working, had 4 inbuilt render engines. Okay, one was called ray tracing, which is used for realistic rendering. One was called toon shading, which was used for cartoon shading. This is not toon shading. Cartoon shading is like with 2D lines and all that. One was software rendering, which used the software part of the technology to render. And one was called hardware rendering, which used the RAM and the CPU and the graphic card to do it. Okay, and these are all different types of technologies, which we'll learn in detail as we study them. But majorly, there were 2 render engines, Mental Ray and RenderMan, which were used for doing these kind of renderings. Okay, and the third was for toon rendering, which is not shown here. It is used to create cartoon style, flat, because everything that you render out of 3D looks 3D. So you can actually render flat style, 2D hand-drawn style rendering out of a 3D animation software. Yes, so rendering is a very time-consuming process, and once you start rendering, you can't do anything with that machine because it utilizes the entire hardware. So RAM, CPU, graphics card, everything is utilized for doing this. So it's a very, very system, resource-hungry process and very mundane. So there is actually a separate department for this. And there's actually a job description. This person is called Render Wrangler, whose job is to press the button and that's it. And he has to, the problem is, the thing is that you can,
he or she is.
He or she, of course. I'm gender neutral, so don't, LGBT or whatever, it doesn't matter. Anyways, the job description is that you have to sit on it and it basically renders a queue. Okay, so it renders number of frames one after the other so that you don't have to press render for every frame. But the person who is the wrangler has to sit and make sure that each frame is getting rendered properly. Okay, because there might be glitches, there might be software hindrances, there might be hardware failures where out of 10 frames it took you 6 hours to render 10 frames and then you realize that 5 frames didn't render.
It could be ghosts in the machine.
It could be anything. Yeah. Till date nobody has found out what does it. I mean, they obviously find out and then they correct that, but the problem persists. There's something else. So that is why there is a whole job, a very well paid job of a person just sitting there and waiting for each render. And when I was working on a project for Disney, we had this thing called Disney Pristine Quality, in which we had to actually make sure that every single pixel has rendered properly. Otherwise, they would send the shot back. So that told us that there was somebody in Disney sitting and looking at every pixel to make sure that everything rendered properly. So yeah, it's you can't bypass this. Otherwise, you cannot take your work out of the software and into a video or whatever. So you can range from realistic rendering like this, so that entire scene is CG. It could be a caricaturized 3D, something like this, or it could be entirely 2D with the technology that we have today. There's a short film called Paperman, which was completely animated in 3D, and then they put toon shading on it, and it looks like it's a 2D animation. Vice versa, Klaus was completely hand animated, and then with lighting, it was given a look of 3D. So that was another technological.
Hand animated as cell animation?
Cell animation, yes.
Also cell
yes,
animation?
Yes, the, and all the characters.
Oh, okay.
Some of the environments are 3D, for which they use compositing techniques, match moving and all that. But all the characters and to some extent even lights and flickering candles and everything was hand animated.
Mm-hmm.
So there is...
Some people only wanted the technology.
No, but they wanted to create this look.
Mm-hmm.
And there are always these people who want to do something which is different from anybody else's work. Like even Paperman, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is such an example. It won an Oscar for the technological achievements. And Klaus is one of the examples where such technology exists.
Okay.
Paperman
is the one where the moon is paper rockets that is sending out, something like that. It's
an animated movie.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. But the storyline is, he makes these paper rockets and he's trying to fly them into her window or something like that.
That is Paperman.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, you said Paperman. I heard Spider-Man.
No.
Sorry. Yes, Paperman is the one.
Okay.
It's a short film. We'll show them. During the process of the course, we'll show them. Okay, next. Okay, so now we come into post-production. Okay, and if you have any questions about Maya, you can ask me. All clear?
Yeah.
So, when you come into post-production, the first thing that you have to do is this is something that I should mention, that when you are rendering, you don't render the whole frame as one single thing. Okay, you render the characters separately, you render the light separately, you render the effects separately, you render the background separately, you render the vehicle separately. So literally every single element of the scene is rendered as separate image sequences. Okay.
So you're not rendering the entire thing at once?
No. And there's a reason for that. I'll tell you. So one way is that you are so good at it that you got it right the first time. Okay? And you rendered the whole image and you send it to the director and director said fantastic job. Okay? Second case scenario is, you rendered the whole image and the director said, instead of blue shading here, I want yellow shading. So then you go back to 3D, you change all the settings and you have to render the whole thing again. Okay, now what I would do is, I would render the sky separately, I would render the light grass trees separately, I would render the dark trees separately, I would render the stem separately, I would render the car's body separately, window separately, light separately, logo separately, metal part separately, wheel separately, the rubber part separately, metal part separately. In that metal, the color, the diffuse, the highlight, the shadows, separate layers. And I would render all of this, and the machine does the job. I just have to set it up. That please render all these elements. I can tell it. And that is the technological advancement, that inside Maya, you can tell the render engine that I want all these things separate. And it will do that. And when the director will say I want yellow there, all you have to do is render that one element and then replace the blue element with that yellow element. And it works. Okay? So this is the reason, when you go to the next slide, where the compositor's job comes. Because the compositor's job is to take all these separate elemental layers and put them together and make sure they still work, because sometimes they don't. Okay, one of the disadvantages could be, and I'm not, but it can happen that sometimes if you render elements separately, the shadow of one object doesn't fall on another object, because when this was rendering, this object was not rendered yet. You know, so there are technical issues that come which the compositor has to solve. Or he has to go back to the render and say, this problem is coming, can you please re-render this? Okay? So all these departments work hand in glove. They are very much interdependent. Okay, and that is one of the skills that you'll have to learn before you can work on a project, is how good are you as a team player? How much do you help others? How much are you open to asking for help? And not try to solve a problem which took you 15 hours, which if you had asked for help could have been solved in 1 hour. You know, so these are also the skills that you'll have to learn. So this is where the compositor is the one guy who cannot work alone. Because he needs so much information from the department before him, and he needs to give so much information to the next department that he needs to have a good rapport with everybody. This is the one guy who cannot make people unhappy with him. Because a lot of his work depends on it. And they will not question the previous department. Once it's with him, it is his problem to solve. And how he solves it is how employable he becomes. Okay? So then, the compositor's job is basically to put all these elements together. Now, in a movie or a whatever industry you're working, sometimes there's a requirement to mix live action footage with animation. Okay? So this could actually be a live action snowscape minus this cable car. This cable car could be created in 3D. And then it's the compositor's job to put them both in one world and make sure the shadows are working, the lighting is working, the perspective is working, everything is working. Although the renderer will make sure the scale is working. Everything is the job of the compositor to make sure it is working. This is used in basic photography also, where they shoot you in front of a particular color, and then they put whichever background. You want flowers in the background, you want church in the background, whatever you want. So it's an age-old technology actually. They figured this out quite early in the visual effects area, that you could remove one color. But then there are other measures that you have to take, that when you're shooting, you have to make sure that there are no wrinkles in this, the green screen, because that causes problem when you're removing, or it's called keying. And then you have to make sure that what color is being used in the background is nowhere on the character, on the person who is being shot. Okay, so that is why, yeah.
The most popular one was the scene of a rhino trying to overturn a jeep, and people are sitting on the jeep looking at the rhino and screaming their heads off. So the people had to sit on the box, turn around and
fake scream. This is one of the challenges that actors face a lot, because they are required to act to things which are not there. You know, like, I mean, Marvel movies are the best example, where Thanos, there's nobody who's 10 feet tall. So they would hold a cardboard up, and that is required for the character to get the correct eye line. So they cannot do it without that, head. But it's a fake head, you know, and the actor is standing there and doing his dialogues. Because the person he's talking to is actually looking 4 feet above him and talking to a fake Thanos. Okay, so I'll show you a compositing reel, and this is basically the next slide. This is basically a showcase of the last 100 years of visual effects. Okay, but it is a bit dated. It might be 10 years old, but it starts 100 years back.
Okay, so it's 90 years then.
90 years. Okay. Thank you.
Does this help?
Yeah, thanks. You mean to tell me that you could have taken your hand out of that cuff at any time?
No, not at any time. Only when it was funny.
Because I didn't make this clip. I just took it from YouTube.
And George, right? They left out George.
There's so many. They're just so.
I think they're 1800s.
Thousands. Yeah. It's just, if I put a clip like that, it'll be ending before. Okay, so this is from the point of compositing, we'll be studying a software called Nuke, which is used in movies. There are other softwares like After Effects and Fusion. After Effects is mostly used for broadcast, but now it has become pretty powerful. And Fusion is Nuke's competitor in the movie market. But Nuke is by far the most... Nuke is like the Maya of compositing. Maya is for 3D animation, Nuke is for compositing. And I worked with Foundry for a couple of years, so I know the software. Okay, next. Editing. So this is the part... The software here is not important. You could use, this is a snapshot of FCP. You could use Premiere, you could use DaVinci, you could use even After Effects. Sorry?
Blender also.
Blender, you could, any editing software. The software is by far the least important thing. The most important thing is how to do it, is the know-how. Okay? And editing is by far pretty much know-how. And you become good at it as you edit more and more. Everybody starts off being a lousy editor. There is no starting point because this is something that cannot be taught. This is every single person has a different idea about how a scene should be edited. So your learning process here would be mostly just learning the tools, and then how you apply those tools is entirely up to you. Of course, you can get guidance from people who are more experienced. So there is, I'm hoping to bring in some specialists from time to time for each department and each module. But we'll see how that works out. You know, with the current situation, I don't know. So editing is basically the art of, once you've done all the compositing and the effects and whatnot, Not really. Editing actually comes before compositing. Because compositing is so if you're making a film, you have to actually lock your edit before you composite. Because compositing even one extra frame takes hours and sometimes days. So if you're not going to end up using it, they don't do the compositing and the renting. Okay, so this process basically simultaneously starts happening once you have the story ready. Okay, and the process is that they actually first create an animatic with the storyboards. They record something called a scratch track, which is basically all the dialogue and all the information about the what is going to happen is recorded with stuff like the animators, and these are not recorded by voice artists. So it's a rough track to get the timing. Okay, and they try to get it as close to. At some point in time, the voice artist will come in and record the voices, and then those voices are replaced and the timing is adjusted. But before you do compositing and before you do visual effects and before you do all that stuff, the edit has to be locked. The sound has to be locked, and then sound, basically locking sound, tells you which visual goes with. Okay? So we used to call it sound lock. And once you achieve sound lock, there's a break. You take a break and you're like, oh, you know, another part is done. Now all we have to do is start rendering. And that is more labor intensive work than creative work. Okay, so in editing, you will be doing video editing and sound editing. And for that, we'll take help of sound recording studios and whatnot. And,
so the editing rhythm is dictated by sound. Therefore, the computer,
yes.
The music first, right?
Yes. So voice and music. And Foley is done after. Foley is the sound effects, because once the animation is done, the Foley artist will look at the final and do the Foley piece. Yeah? So sound has three. Yeah? One is the voice, the dialect recording. One is the background music, which sets the mood. And third is called Foley, or sound effects, which could be lightning, leaves rustling, paper crumbling, footsteps, breathing, you know, any kind of sound effects that you can hear when you have a camera running in the background, you know, it could be any noise other than the dialogue and the music. Okay? And this is where what comes out of editing is what you see and what you upload on YouTube, and you know, that's the final product. The final product comes out of editing. Okay? And here what I've done is I've actually broken down the whole course. This is actually a 5 days a week, 3 years course for people who want to pursue it as a degree course. So it starts with concept design, character design, storyboarding, color theory. This is basically 6 months of education. So 2 months, 2 months, 1 month, 1 month, and then 12 principles are taught over 6 months. So we do two principles every month, and then this is the first year of studying. Then next. Second year is production, 6 modules, 2 months, 2 months, 2 months, 2 months, 2 months, 2 months. This is the entire second year. And this can vary, okay? Because this is more technical. So you can learn this in 1 month, and then we can spend more time doing animation, which is skill-based. So you know, so this can be flexible, but it takes a whole year to do it. Okay, rendering is again technical. But the technical person has to have a lot of artistic skill also. So it's not that you cannot be an artist and just start doing this. Dynamics is physical simulation. So although you need to know how to technically do it, you need to see that the ball is bouncing properly or not. You know? So there are a lot of technical aspects. The texturing is purely technical. The application of the texture on the model is very technical work. It is not creative. But creating the texture that goes in the model is creative. You have to paint it. People usually use a software like Photoshop or Photoshop to do that. Okay? And rendering also involves lighting and shading. So it's not just that. 1 second. This also involves how the shading is, you know, how the lights are reflected. All those have to be, decisions have to be taken by the render person, not the wrangler, the person who's setting up the settings for them. And lastly, this is where you learn this much is visual effects and then editing. Okay? So in visual effects, you'll learn how to composite digital on digital, how to compose in digital or live action. There's a thing called rotoscopy. There are some things which you will not be able to do using automatic techniques. An example I talked about last time was that if I take your photo in this place, I cannot remove you from that photo because there is no single color in your background. So if I have to remove you as an element, I have to actually trace you and remove the background by tracing you, and like in Photoshop, create a layer and trace the character, and then remove whatever outside, and then fill that with the new environment. And then, of course, that doesn't end the job because he's inside. If I'm showing him sitting in the garden, the entire lighting on him has to change to match the garden. Otherwise, it will just look like a cutout. Okay, so that is, it's a very, very skill-based position, but it also requires a lot of technical knowledge. Okay, so rotoscopy is that part. The term rotoscopy comes from an animation technique, which was used to animate long before people used pencil pencils. It's called, what they would do is they would shoot everything in live action and then trace it frame by frame. And then that tracing was shown on screen. And one of the best examples is the first Disney feature film. Do you know which one it is?
Bambi?
No.
Oh, no.
First
Snow White.
Feature film. Mickey Mouse was an animated shorts. Yeah. First animated feature film from Disney, the entire animation for the Snow White character is rotoscope. It is traced. They actually shot a person wearing those clothes and then traced. And everything else, so that is why when you see that movie, if you see it again, you will see that it's very realistic. Mm-hmm. Her movements are very, very refined, very realistic. And you will see that all the characters around her, the seven dwarves and everybody else, is so cartoony. You know, it's very caricaturized because they hand animated. Okay, so that's how they did use rotoscopy in animation. And then that same technology was used for compositing to separate elements from each other. Okay, so it retains the name. Camera match move is the technology, a technique which we use for matching real world camera, which I talked about, with the virtual camera. So the entire movement of the real world camera is captured and put on the virtual camera, and then the virtual camera moves exactly the way the cameraman moved the camera in real world. Okay, but it's based on images and pixels and many things, which we'll learn. And then finally, video and sound editing. So we could use separate softwares for them. Editing softwares are not very well designed for sound mixing and all, but they have some tools. So you can actually do basic sound editing in an editing software. But if you have glitches, if you have background sound that you want to remove, like birds chirping or fan going in the background or somebody dropping a mic, you know, some kind of sound that comes in your, see, then you need specialized softwares like Audition or, you know, the software, Soundtrack Pro in mind, which are specially designed for sound editing and mixing. Okay? And then they are also used for mixing the three types of sounds, so that depending on what is important, whether a dialogue is important, then the music and the foley should be less. And if you want to show the crackling of the sound and there's dialogue in that scene, then if the crackling of the sound has to overshadow the dialogue, so all that mixing has to be done by an artist. It's all recorded at the same value, but when mixing, which one goes up, which one goes down, has to be manually done. Okay? And that's it.
Who's Abhijit Roy
here? Yeah, I'm one of the mouse.
I'm sure the one with the cake that
I used
parties.
To be like this. I am like this. Before and after. Yeah. So that's me, and that's the entire thing. Animation is just the illusion of motion. Mm. You know, so if that's how we define animation. What is animation? Animation is an illusion of motion. Mm. It's not real motion. Mm. You know, Bugs Bunny is not running inside the screen.
Yeah.
He's just a number of pictures, and that is why he's limited to the screen. He cannot jump out. Because he's just a drawing, and the drawing again and again has been drawn to show movement, and when you run them at minimum 12 frames a second, ideally 24, 25 or 30 frames per second, you get animation.
What if you increase the frames of 60 or 70?
Yeah, so it just becomes more smoother, it's more crisper.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's just so much more work. Let me assure you that what Sassy said is
sheer.
Yeah, the sheer amount of, I would use another word, S letter word, the shitload of work that you have to do to create animation is just mind-boggling. And that is why you require a huge team of artists, ranging from 200 to 300 per film. And it would take them almost 3 years to make film. Yeah, it takes a long time. It's not like shooting.